what Earl's dad doesn't know is I'm taking secret lessons. Well done for sort of making it through a very long day and I'll try and make this worthwhile for you. Fill my brief and you can see what I'm going to try and do. I'm going to try and paint a picture for you of how we get from the road on the left to the road on the right. And everyone in this audience knows the difference between the two roads, knows that we are very firmly on the road on the left, beyond this impression thereof, and also knows that we can get to that road on the right with existing technologies. And what I was asked to talk about was not just the technology, but also briefly mention the holistic sort of strategy and tactics. Can we get there just using the technology? My personal answer to that, and I think the answer of growing numbers of people, especially young people, is no. You know, there's wonderful technology that exists, but we have got to deal with the politics as well. So there's a little checklist here that I'll work my way through, and you can read them as I'm talking. But I'm just briefly going to touch on each one of these and show you some of the things that are going on, some of the things that could be going on. And I'm going to finish with this additional item on the checklist, which is, you know, what we want is technologies that can work with the changes in re-engineering, modern form of capitalism, which is failing us so spectacularly, to give ourselves a better chance of finally getting onto that road on the right. So that's a road, visioning the future, that is 100% renewable power. Heard of other options today, but this is the option I'm going to be describing to you. It will be powered by a family of technologies that are already, in many cases, as you have heard, subject to plunging costs and exploding growth rates. Wind will be very important in its different forms, current and future. Water, renewable technologies will be very important, be they marine or on land. And then appropriate biomass, biogas, biofuels will clearly be some part of the mix. You know, the definition of the word appropriate is probably subject for another lecture, but the member of the family or the group of technologies in the family that I want to emphasize, because it's the one I know best, is solar. And all those installations you see there in their different attributes are installations spread by my company, which, for those of you who don't know it, is a downstream, mostly solar photovoltaic company. Since 2000, we have been, year on year, the fastest growing renewable energy company in Britain. That doesn't make us necessarily successful, because we are in Britain, where in the league table of European countries, 27 countries, we are third from bottom, above only Malta and Luxembourg. So this is an element of the challenge that we face in this particular country. But I will run through the list, the checklist, which applies to anything we can talk about. You've got to be able to show that there are meaningful carbon savings. This is a big issue, because too many discussions are devoid of, you know, real carbon reductions. Tar sands, for example, how much gas do you have to burn, how much gasoline you have to burn in order to put in place the kit that can then heat the water to melt the tar to give you the barrel oil. And the answer to that is, you know, a big number once you've done it. So solar electricity, carbon reductions are pretty good. Not perfect, no free lunches in this. Here you can see a 10 megawatt solar farm under construction in Abu Dhabi, and the amount of carbon that it saves, displacing gas and oil, oil burning and electric power lines. Big story to watch if you're interested in oil depletion and a bit of coal. And not much point in it's just a grid-scale solar plant without a context, and this does have a context, that's why I'm showing it to you, because it's part of the City of Master, which is an Abu Dhabi government project, like so many renewable projects, subject to problems at the moment, but the intention is there, the intention is clear. This is a government that does not like burning oil, not for the reasons we would like, but for the reason that they wanted to export, they don't want to be burning in their electric power plants, but they're adding to, because only Qatar and Iran have really got enough gas in the Middle East. So a good project, a low-carbon city under construction at the moment with all the architects' drawings you'd expect from all that talented architects working in design, Foster's and elsewhere, as an internal view of the low-carbon city and its environment. And close to home, you know, if we look, we know we can do this kind of thing. This is the UK's first solar-powered roof tile home, solar roof tile home. I lived in it for a year, so I know how well it can afford this. That small roof generating more electricity than I and my daughter consumed with pretty much constant occupancy. And here is something even more impressive, more recent. This is Greenwood Way, a low-income housing development put together by Scottish and Southern, with our roof tiles made in Britain on the roof, providing tons of solar electricity, way more than these houses need. And the other thing to note, you can't see it here, but in the utility room, you've got three separate renewable energy technologies that are each providing all the heat that this development uses. So it's way beyond zero carbon, and it's in slab. You can go visit it. Here's what it really looks like. The previous one was an architect's impression. It's a community. You can see the way the design objects are in there. It's a sort of future thinking thing as well. And the excess solar electricity is used to charge the community electric vehicle. And right now, sadly, the cable's only going one way, but I think everyone here will appreciate it and listen to it. Like Mason was saying just before the turn, you know, it's not going to be long before these cables are two-way. So the little vehicles are themselves going to be storage plants, power plants. That's not just a residential story. When you get on to big commercial buildings, of course, you're providing way, way more electricity than the buildings use, you know, the warehouses in many cases. Plenty for export to the grid. You can do it vertically, no chance of providing all the electricity used in that building as a bank headquarters in Manchester. But it doesn't matter anyway, because you've just got free electricity because you're competing with decorative, pricing decorative but functionless material. And here's another installation for the Olympics coming up. It's also a heating story as well. So we manufacture solar thermal tiles. The lighter tiles here are solar thermal. So this is solar combined heating power in that really sunny county of Yorkshire. And you know, this is a big prize, because with this technology alone, you can be very close to zero carbon in these homes where you haven't had the A-grade lighting and heating efficiency that you have in some of the others that we've developed. And this is half UK emissions in buildings, half of them in residential. So this is a big opportunity, even in a cloudy country. Not a magic bullet, there are no magic bullets. You've got to use the other members of the family as well. What we're looking for is fast growth. You know why. The climate problem is very acute. We're looking for what the internet people call tipping points, places where you know you get enough momentum that you get inflection points and things begin to spread, products, ideas, at the speed of viral infections. So renewables have been creeping slowly upwards, with the exception of solar thermal effects. You can't quite see the years, but that inflection point is 2004. And it's very important that I think people appreciate that we are now the renewables in many countries providing most of the electricity, new electricity that's coming on stream. So in 47% of all new power capacity in that period in Europe in 2009, look at this, new capacity installed, all and half of it wind and solar. In Europe and America both, these last 2 years, more renewable capacity has come on stream than all fossil fuel and nuclear combined. Don't let the opposition tell you that we're so far behind that we can't catch up. We could, if we have the will. I'll get to the will. We don't want constraints. No point in these technologies if, you know, we don't have enough materials for them, or they're constrained by geography. And Shell has the lead in this. This famous picture which shows the calculations done in Shell of a number of the renewables family, members of the family, in every continent for a world of 10 billion people, all consuming energy at a preposterous rate that we do in the European Union. Only in the European Union would we need energy efficiency. particularly the potential of solar. This is one portrayal of how much uranium, gas, oil, and coal there is relative to your annual global consumption. You know, there are different views on exactly how big those spheres are, but the point is that they are tiny, they're finite, that's all there is, and they're tiny compared to the annual picture for solar. So tap just a bit of that and imagine what we can do. It's not as though this is controversial. Governments know this. Tony Blair said it in 2003, way back, energy white paper. We could go zero carbon with these technologies, with solar energy alone. I was 10 feet away from it when he said this. Solar energy alone could meet world energy demand, not electricity demand, energy demand, using less than 1% of land area up in the crossing pasture. You wouldn't need to use that land. You want it for crossing pasture, the way things are going. But you could use rooftops. And even in a country like cloudy Britain, with its tiny solar market that nonetheless can be seen from space, as you see here, I ask the question, what could we do if we were silly enough to put existing solar technology on every available good space in the facade? We wouldn't do that because we're not a magic bullet. We want to mix and match with all the other brothers and sisters in the family. But if we did it, this is what we shall calculated a few years ago. If we use south-facing roofs only, we could do 35% of our current profit electricity. If we use all building mounted, we could do more than the total. All the figures are in the study that are on the Solar Century website. George Monbiot doesn't like this argument for some reason, but it's there, all based on land registry stats. And after all, how surprising is it that the fastest growing solar market in the world is Germany? And look at the insulation comparison between the UK and Germany. Now look at the insulation comparison between Germany and the United States. Germany's equivalent to rainy Seattle. And look at that resource, particularly in the southwest states. Think about where that's going to go in the future. Resource constraints on the value chain. You appreciate that sand is melted in crystalline silicon ingots at the top end to produce the systems. There's plenty of sand around. We're talking about one of the most silica, one of the most common elements. Some resource constraints for thin film technologies, for sure, with the trace elements, but you know, we don't have the problem that some people have. We need it to make economic sense, obviously. If it's preposterously expensive, then well, we just have to burn the planet, really. We wouldn't have any choice because coal would be so cheap, right? But that's not the case. The small amounts of subsidies that have gone into these technologies relative to conventional fuel have produced such spectacular systemic cost down in manufacturing that really we can have great hope as a result of this. Here you see wind and solar. Solar in recent years, just spectacular. And people are picking it up. These are economics correspondents in the papers. You get like Guardian's former economics correspondent actually talking about the economics of solar without a fee tariff, if you read that. 3.5% return against the current retail price of electricity. That's better, he says, than any so-called savings account with the bonus cultists that he could possibly find on the high street. Now you might say, therefore, why do we need a feed-in tariff? Answer, as we can build a domestic industry as quick as we can, but with a feed-in tariff at the rate we did have before the government ambushed us, you could get an 8%, maybe a bit more, return. That's what the other articles are talking about. So the principle of this is huge, and the opportunity is magnificent, because here you see what we can do. Our costs are coming down. The conventional costs, gas, oil, coal, nuclear, all going up. Maybe a different story with gas, depending on whether we're stupid enough to allow mass fracking on the planet. But that's the conventional energy picture, as you know, from paying energy bills. Our costs are coming down, so PV is sort of roughly where the mode line is. And you can borrow from the future the savings you know you're going to make. Governments and local governments will underwrite these as green bonds in order to pay the price of all the investment you need to just get down to grid parity. You can get even more sophisticated and roll in the low-hanging fruits, the energy fruits, this is what we would do if we had a meaningful Green New Deal at the time. We would need to generate the jobs in the numbers we need to redress the job losses that are coming inevitably because of austerity. All this would be done if the government had the will, if it didn't face the kind of systemic defence of the ruinous, suicidal status quo that it was getting from the big energy companies at the moment. I'll come back to that at the end. For me, and the boys and girls of the silver century, one of the things we're most encouraged by is social housing. So this is where fuel poverty comes in. We started the company 12 years ago. Selling solar to housing associations was like trying to sell sand to the Arabs. I mean, you know, it was really difficult. And the people would say, this is so expensive, why would we do it? It's crazy. Now we talk to housing associations, ordering rooms by the thousand, who are telling us that we think, and this guy, who's the energy manager of South Yorkshire, says this, we think this is our single biggest tool in fighting fuel poverty going forward. Hence, one of the biggest tragedies of the government's giving in to the big six energy companies, EDF and the rest, lobbying for an ambush feed-in tariff. We have got to go fast. Climate change is one of the reasons we've got to go fast. Here's another. I don't have any time to try and persuade you that peak oil is a problem, but if it's something that's new to you, I commend you the website of this industry task force that Solar Century members of. It's chaired by Arup. Virgin used to chair it, Scottish and Southern are on it. This is what the various chief executives and chairmen said in the second report that we produced. We're really worried that the narrative about oil supply is going to collapse on us in the same way that the investment bankers' narrative on complex derivatives and mortgage-backed securities can collapse. So we don't believe their hype. And this is what we say. You know, we're in a non-climate society, we thought we're wrong with our analysis, but we think that global oil supply is going to collapse, and then drop, maybe collapse by 2015 at the latest. And it's not about how much oil there is, there's plenty of oil. It's about flow rates. It's about deliverable flow rates against supply. So if you remember one thing from this half an hour talk, please let it be this warning that there are people right in the trucks industry who are not being listened to. We are not environmentalists, environment groups, but people at the top of industry who are being ignored by government, ignored by big energy, because we are telling an uncomfortable narrative and issuing a warning about something that's going to happen on your watch if you're right, or even halfway right. And it'll be the biggest thing of your working lives. And that's all I have to say about it, unfortunately, because of the time, but that's what the final diagram looks like. That curve is supposed to keep on going to feed what's going on in India and China and the Middle East, but we think, and sadly, it's going to, actually, maybe not sadly, but the climate is going to start dropping. So we've got to move fast, we've got to install things that we can do in months, and we can. This is another picture, it's a social housing development with solar PV, solar thermal, pretty close to very low carbon, depending on, you know, what you do with the energy efficiency, all plug and play, easy, in fact even fun to install, and some of the bigger technologies that are possible in South Europe and Spain and across the Sun Belt. They too only take, you know, a few years to put up one of these solar thermal plants. Nuclear, in contrast, by their own admission, 10 years or more from the drawing board to connection to the grid. I'm telling you, we don't have 10 years to solve some of these problems. That's the challenge. I don't have time to talk about nuclear either, but the one thing I would do is, if you haven't made up your mind, confident that nuclear is part of the solution, please, please dig a little bit. Look below the mantras. Much of this debate is sort of wage in mantras. Nuclear is low carbon, therefore it's going to be good. Look at their operational and performance record. How are they doing at Old Palmyra? How are they doing at Flamanville? I tell you how they're doing. If we'd asked Ben Elton to write a comedy novel about this 10 years ago, we wouldn't believe what's going on in these sites. They're billions over budget, they're years behind schedule, and this is just the start. So dig, before you form a considered opinion about nuclear. And I give a website which I'll show at the end that actually goes through the trauma of what's going on. In contrast, how about that for a solar movement in Berlin? That's how it was installed in December, in the snow. Thousands of modules, kilometers of string cable, tons of central inverters. We did it in 10 weeks in the snow. This is a very important point. Energy efficiency, of course, as well. Very short question there. Running economies, can we do it? I think the most encouraging, there's a number of things I can talk about here, but the studies, the modeling that's been done at Stanford and Berkeley by that group, summarized in Scientific American and elsewhere, looking at the target of 11.5 terawatts by 2030. Massive resource, far more resource, and this sort of takes out the mountains and the cities and all these areas where you couldn't do renewables. And this is one of their formulations. You can cut this cake a different number of different ways. Notice they don't use biomass, consider it too controversial, but just done solar, wind, and water technologies. And you can, you know, work it out down to how many plants, power plants you need of different sizes in each of the sectors around the place globally to power the world economy at the larger level of energy consumption that they're assuming in 2030, and do it by 2030. And here's the important thing, if you don't know this, is the important thing. None of the mobilization rates would be any faster than many technology mobilization rates we have already achieved. Internal combustion engine, mobile phone, and the rest. All that's missing is the imagination and the will to do it, which is partly where you come in. And here's just one day modeled. Storage isn't important. I mean, you might basically like storage as well, and there's only great stuff in storage. We don't actually need it though. We could do this by mixing and matching the technologies. And you can see a day in California, how it would be done, according to their modeling. The Germans have done it at the level of a scale experiment. Very minimal storage, a bit of pumped hydro, that storage, but mostly just mixing and matching wind, hydro, biogas, and a bunch of other stuff. And they run it nationwide in different weather conditions, financed by the Ministry of Economics, no problem at all. There's the website for that particular reference as well. Jobs. We've got to create jobs. The International Labour Organization came out with a figure for how many young people are out of work now. This is going to affect you all. I've forgotten it. It was horrific. I probably forgot it on purpose, it was so horrific. But this stuff is job rich. We need a Green New Deal. We need it fast and hard, and energy efficiency in particular can do it. We should be going in all our countries, house by house, street by street, community by community. None of this pathetic dabbling that you see in the current government's Green Deal. We need something much bigger, much more meaningful. Photovoltaics, not particularly job-rich compared to energy efficiency, but we had got up to getting off 30,000 jobs under the feed-in tariff since it came in April 2010. Many of those thousands are now being cast back onto the scrap heap because of what the government has done to us under the malign influence of the big energy companies. These are good jobs, happy people, neat kit. You know, these are our Made in Britain solar roof tiles. There's a wonderful video on our website, I don't know if it's still there, but you know, roofer basically saying, well, God, it's so easy, it's just like normal roofing with a few wires. Of course, they don't connect the wires to the grid. And you know, a company like Solar Century, here we are, you know, average age, I don't know what, in the late 20s or early 30s, average age in the oil and gas industry, you know what it is? 49. Average retirement age, 55. Legacy problem? Anyone? Unbelievable. But, you know, a relatively small number of people can, you know, through outsourcing and through training, you know, create things to be really proud of. Imagine this. This is Black Forest Bridge. It's the longest solar bridge in the world. Arctic's roaring. It's under construction at the moment. See if you solar modules going up. This was sold to Network Rail by a young lady not long out of university, I don't know how many years, 3 years, something like that. You know, she got this job because the more senior salespeople didn't think she'd ever be able to sell it. She did. And the guy, the engineer, the lead engineer for us, project manager again, not many more years out of the university. Imagine how proud those kids are going to be when they see this thing connected to the grid, with the intelligent cameras of the world on it when the Olympics opens up later this summer. Not just about developed countries, it's about developing countries. Gotta fix this as well. Can't draw up the drawbridge. And this famous picture, you've seen kind of a version of this before. You know, where's all the sun across the equatorial belt? Where are all the lights on in the drought countries further north? How skew-whiff is that? So development, very important. And you know, the model we have of giving 5% of our profits to solar aid, a charity of our own design, is, I think, one that we wish many other corporates would follow. So here's some of our ads. What we do, I guess, we train Africans. It's a self-help model, it's not an aid model. So we train Africans to set up solar lighting businesses. We're trying to put the kerosene lantern out of work. We're active in 4 countries now. We've leveraged a ton of money from other governments and other corporates. It's great, great work. Big feedback loops between the company and the charity, obviously. Loads of fundraising, loads of advice. We also solarize schools. We've done hundreds of schools in most countries. That's the kind of kit we put on the schools. These are places on miles from anywhere. They're totally pitch black, apart from the dangerous kerosene lanterns, if they don't have solar systems. This is what they look like if they do have a solar system. And the average grades are going up in these schools. We've only been doing it 3 years. Right across these countries now, the results are coming in, the grades are going up, because they've got 4 extra hours of homework at the end. Building security. I'm not going to lecture you about Iraq and oil and going to war for fossil fuels. I don't trust myself to do that. So let me just talk about other aspects of security. Shell's Bonga field, miles and miles off of Nigeria. Nigeria is supposed to be an alliance in OPEC. This field was still attacked by pirates, or freedom fighters, whatever. You know, the particular view of them, terrorists, they were different things, usual story. Then there's the normal routine operational problems, increasing of the fossil fuel industries. And we haven't yet had our first exploding LNG tanker, God forbid that we do, but these things are little nuclear bombs floating around. There's also the personal security aspect. French farmers call our chalet, solar rooftop roofs, pensions, and there's a good reason for that, because they provide pension-type income. Here's some more pensions, real roofs. What happened to this very nice business doing good in France? It was completely killed by EDF, which is one of the big 6 energy companies, also, of course, effectively the Ministry of the French State. It's majority owned by the French government. They just chopped the feed-in tariff. We have to breed hope. I don't know if any of you went to Copenhagen, but I did for 2 weeks. I came back very not with the students, many of the students who've gone there and been treated so desperately by the astonishingly, worryingly fascistic Danish police who see them all incarcerated for doing nothing but peaceful protest on the right there, sitting in the freezing cold. I tell you, that was really depressing for me, listening to their conversation. University students utterly deflated by the failure of governments, by the failure of their tens of thousands to make any impact on civil process. So we have got to find a way of getting past this kind of thing. This is the Chinese delegation out of work in Copenhagen. And the group at the bottom, of course, is the American delegation. Perfect representation of that. So anything that we can do with this kind of stuff is vital. And one of the things that is so heartening for us is we're doing hundreds of schools in Britain and Italy in particular, often with corporate partners like Scottish and Southern. And you see, the way this plays in the schools is just incredible. And there are hundreds of thousands of kids that go through these schools in the time that the system is alive. The lessons are all fashioned around, and can be fashioned. Science around the schools, and it's actually difficult sometimes when we're hoping ceremonies for, you know, teachers not to turn their classes of kids into embryonic campaigners. So, bringing the Pope is important. Now, the final thought before I stop, and I'm not going to dwell on this because I think there are some obvious points here. It ain't working the way we've got it at the moment. Those of you doing business will know, you know, the importance of making a strong case for your business model to investors. The gentleman on the left is Chuck Prince, who was chief executive of Citi Group, and this is what he said. When the first warnings were being made about the toxicity of complex derivatives, I'll translate that for you. It basically means, look, everyone's doing it, we've got no damn choice, we're just going to keep doing it until the bubble bursts. And indeed. I mean, what kind of an argument is that given to the Wall Street Journal? We've got to keep dancing. Pathetic. And with the benefit of hindsight, you know, crypto true, really. And then the time for remorse about Magnus Bonuses is over in this rather cheerful chappy. There is, of course, Bob Diamond, interesting names. But could be fundamental is Bob Diamond. You know, one of the most senior bankers of Barclays was called Richie Rich. Did you know that? Does God have a sense of humor or what? But the time for remorse about Bonuses is over. Well, sorry, Bob, you know, he got so sacked down for this. He had to blow in big time. And you don't hear this kind of rhetoric from these guys anymore. They're on the run, so they should be. And, you know, Tony, my old graduate student mate, I want my life back, he whined to the world's media. Can you imagine? After 15 people have just lost theirs. Anyway, what's he doing now? Is he in payback mode, or working for a charity somewhere, full of remorse? No, he's allowed to go off and buy and sell oil fields, banked with money from pension funds that is often our pension money, and he transferred his first 10 million quid from these games played with really dubious partners in Turkey, backed by British pension fund money. These are only two examples of where modern capitalism has lost the plot. They're allowed to get away with it, we're allowed to get away with it. It's worse than this because, of course, they also, you know, massage the truth. This is VP under Tony. When we added the energy fix, it's an energy mix. We don't just do oil and gas, we use solar and all that good stuff. VP pulled out solar 100% in December 2011. And this isn't actually all that controversial. Financial Times headline from just a few days ago. Cameron admits UK's lost faith in capitalism. Well, I actually hope he meant lost faith in modern capitalism, in the form of capitalism into which we have allowed it to evolve. And of course, the FT's been running a series, which if you haven't seen it, it's worth Googling, just contrast the articles by Mr. Miliband and Mr. Roswell, Capitalism in Crisis. And so nowadays, people can publish books like Prosperity Without Growth. Commentary at the Financial Times may actually write about the very appalling proposition that had them carted off to jail as lunatics just 2 years ago, that actually, maybe, we're coming to the end of growth and we need new models. So I sort of end my story there, except to say, things like this, which could so easily have been marginalised, middle-class takeovers of banks, turning them into, in the left, top left there, a nursery, top right, they sound to be a laundry. You know, it would be easy for banks to dismiss this as just, you know, rabble rousing and stuff to be suppressed. They can't do it any longer. And if you look at the Occupy movement and the way that is now taken seriously in America, since the famous opinion poll that showed that 60% of people intending to vote Republican actually favoured what Occupy Wall Street movement were doing, then, you know, you've got change in society. And don't shoot the messenger. This will offend some of you, particularly those of you who have had work experience in investment banks and who voted Conservative at the last election. But, you know, this is the time. This isn't to in a national newspaper, the Daily Telegraph. No, a lot. Good. But you know, it's this zeitgeist that we're dealing with here. This is really potent imagery. And notice just in passing what's happening in the background. Angels are installing solar panels. And one of them is a High Court judge. And of course, this came out just after the judgment, the first judgment. So, you know, my argument, I think many people would argue, we're not going to get to the road of the right just by, you know, following technology. We've got to think through big mega strategies to get there. Otherwise, if we stay on the road to the left, this is what's going to happen. This is not a futuristic picture. This is a natural picture from a mining company's AGM taken last year. And then, of course, all this stuff about an out-of-control police force with the database society. And any of you who've been to demos know that your video, you know, you go into the database, really worrying stuff if we keep going on this track. So my closing thought, one for you, if you intend to work in this zoo, which is the clean tech markets, this is the Financial Times portrayal of it. It's very dangerous. Patience is a virtue in the hunt for game-changing green Google. What they're saying is that there hasn't been a green Google yet. You might say, well, why not, if everything that you've said is sublimely obvious, why is there no green Google? There's no green Google in solar. There's no green Google in any of the renewables families, any of the clean tech technologies yet. And why is that? That's the question I'm going to leave you with, including my answer. The reason is that there is a quasi-institutionalized, deeply enculturated defense of the status quo. It's there in the business community, it's there in the financial sector, it's there in the civil service. I see it every day in my working life. No great overarching conspiracy, just people desperately resistant to change, desperate to believe comforting narratives, when actually what's facing them is uncomfortable narratives. An obvious solution that involves seismic change, that change that is absolutely possible. And what we're looking for are these tipping points, these things that can make ideas, products go viral. And that book, if you don't know it, by Malcolm Gladwell, very inspirational, read, well worth it. We've done it before. Groups of human beings have done amazing and unexpected things. The Berlin Wall did come down, Nelson Mandela did walk free. And the Americans did put the person on the moon by the end of the decade. They said they were going to do it, unless you believe it was on stage at Leggett. So, this is what faces you. I commend the set of activities involved in delivering this vision to you. I think that my generation created this problem, and your generation is going to have to solve it for us. Thank you very much for listening to me. And